بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وموالاه. So alhamdulillah, this week we will be going through the chapter Babu ma jaa fi bukaa'i Rasulillah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The chapter on the weeping of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A person weeps, cries because of some reason. At times one cries because of mercy and kindness. At times because of fear, sometimes because of fondness and love, sometimes due to intense happiness, sometimes due to pain or sorrow, at times due to the oppression of someone. Amongst these, there is the crying of tawbah, repentance, which is a result of some sin committed. One type of crying is due to nifaq, hypocrisy, which is done for show. So a person just makes it look as if he is crying, but in reality it's not really from inside. Where one cries in salah so that others may feel that person is crying due to piety, humbleness, etc. One type of crying is for a request. For instance, when one cries for a dead person without taking any money in return, anything in return. One is to cry for money, where one is paid to cry at the house of a dead person. People, even they think this is a business, as is the custom in some areas. One type of crying is the crying of acceptance, where one sees another crying and after seeing this, he begins to cry. Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mainly cry due to the fondness and love for a deceased person, or for fear of on behalf of the ummah, or because of the fear of longing for Almighty Allah subhanallah. These were the reasons Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam cries. As will be seen in the hadith that we will be doing now, only these types of crying are praiseworthy. The mashayikh have written, one type of crying is called a lie, that is crying of a person after committing a sin, but thereafter does not refrain from that sin. A person seems to be contradicting his own self. The commentators on hadith write, the crying of Sayyidina Dawud alayhi salam was due to sorrow. The crying of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam was due to a desire, and the crying of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, subhanallah, his crying was because of love. According to this humble servant, Hazrat Shaykh Zakiyyah rahmatullahi alayhi, this will mean that he mostly cried at night due to love. Otherwise, Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam cried due to different reasons. So at night it was mainly for the love of Almighty Allah. Otherwise he cried at different times for different reasons, which has been mentioned in different hadith. Therefore the different types of narration will be mentioned. So this is a chapter on the crying of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The tears that come out of the eyes, the tears that come out of the eyes, you know, which makes us remember how, makes us understand how rich the Arabic language is. Hazrat Maulana Abul Hasan Ali Nadwi, he was mentioning that he had an eye operation somewhere in America. So after the operation they told him, don't cry, don't weep. So he said, I started thinking that the water that comes out of the eyes, the tears that come out, in English they only have two words, crying, weeping. In Arabic there are around 300 words, just for the tears that come out. You know, out of love, you know, all these different types of tears that come out of the eyes. When some person is in happiness, tears come out. When a person is in grief, tears come out. When a person is begging something, tears come out. When a person is sometimes eating something really spicy, tears come out. It has all different names. It just makes us understand how rich the Arabic language is, the language of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the language of Quran. حدثنا سويد بن نصر حدثنا عبد الله بن مبارك عن حماد بن سلمة عن ثابت عن مطغف وهو ابن عبد الله بن مش شخير عن أبيه قال أتيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو يصلي ولجوفه أزيز كأزيز المرجل من البكاء. الله أكبر. عبد الله بن شخير رضي الله عنه says I attended the noble gathering of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. He was performing salah because of his crying, such a sound emitted from his blessed chest like that of a boiling pot. Allahu Akbar. This was due to total humbleness of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some scholars have written that this state of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam occurred when both of the Jalali and the Jamali attribute of Almighty Allah appeared together. You know, when is the power of Almighty Allah, like Allah is Qahhar, Allah is Malikul Mulk. So these mention the power of Almighty Allah, how powerful He is, and creates that type of awe in a person. That is known as Jalal. And then you have Mercy, Ghaffar, Rahman, Rahim, which, you know, shows us how merciful He is, how kind He is. That is known as Jamal. So when both of these used to get together, then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to cry like this. None can control the appearing of the Jalali attribute. Certainly, when the Jamali attribute appeared at the time of some sort of happiness and contentment became apparent, though the mediation to fail of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the mashaykh of Suluk also experienced these two conditions. So when they see out of the love of Allah they cry, or out of the fear of Allah they cry, and that is iman. Bayn al khawf wa raja. A person sometimes he's in the love of Allah he's crying, and in the fear of Allah he's crying. And if a person has this type of life, and a person lives this type of life, then inshallah, that will get him closer to Almighty Allah. And this tear is enough. These tears that come out of the fear of Allah in repentance at the time of turning to Allah, these are so valuable. So valuable. It is enough to extinguish the fire of Jahannam. Otherwise in Akhirah, a person will cry and cry and cry and cry and regret. His tears will finish. His blood will come out, blood will finish, sweat will come out, sweat will finish, but that will be of no use. حدثنا محمود بن غيلان حدثنا معاوية بن هشام حدثنا سفيان عن الأعمش عن إبراهيم عن عبيد عن عبد الله بن مسعود قال قال لي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم اقرأ علي فقلت يا رسول الله أقرأ عليك وعليك أنزل قال إني أحب أن أسمعه من غيري فقرأت سورة النساء حتى بلغت وجئنا بك على هؤلاء شهيدا قال فرأيت عيني رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم تهملان. الله أكبر. Another type of crying of رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu says Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam once asked me to recite the Quran to him. He might have said this because one may be able to concentrate more if one listens, or he may have said this for another reason. So even to hear the Quran is a sunnah of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which may include many reasons. For example, the learning of the recital of the Quran is regarded as a sunnah. As a result, this deed of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the hearing of the Quran, is also a sunnah because of this. I said, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu said, I said, O Prophet of Allah, should I recite it to you when it has been revealed to you? Sayyidina ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu may have thought this recital was for tabligh, as a means of conveying the message, as a reminder. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I love to hear it from another person. Thereupon I began reciting Surah An-Nisa, the fourth surah in the Quran, which begins from the last quarter of the fourth para, fourth juz. When I reached this ayah, فَكَيْفَ إِذَا جِئْنَا مِن كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ بِشَهِيدٍ وَجِئْنَا بِكَ عَلَى هَٰؤُلَاءِ شَهِيدًا. But how will it be when we will bring of every people a witness, and we will bring you, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a witness against them? Ajib, subhanallah. When Allah mentions this, I saw tears flowing from both eyes of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The crying of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was due to the listening of the words of Allah, and this befits the dignity of the Quran. Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi writes that to cry while reciting the Quran is the quality of the arifin, those who have recognized Almighty Allah, arifin, and a sign of salihin, pious people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has praised these people in the Quran at many places. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُ. When the recitation of the Quran was recited, then they start weeping. وَإِذَا سَمِعُوا مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَى الرَّسُولِ تَرَى أَعْيُنَهُمْ. Allah mentions many places, different places in the Quran, but it is clear that who can confirm more to these ayat than Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? It is not imagination that the crying of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was due to the greatness and jalal of the Quran, the might, the power of the Quran. In this case, it is possible that Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam must have been crying from before, not. And Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu must have observed it only after Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had been crying for some time. So only afterwards he realized that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was crying. In this manner, amazing, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was crying whilst the Quran is being recited. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had been crying for some time. It may also be possible that he began crying specially after the recital of the ayah. The translation of the ayah is, how will it be when we will bring from every people a witness, and we will bring you, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a witness against them? Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam will be called to give evidence on these people. This is the scene of Qiyamah. On that day, every prophet will be called upon to give evidence as a witness. The events of which are described in detail in the ahadith of the day of Qiyamah. In this manner, it is possible that this crying of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam will be due to the difficult times on the day of Qiyamah and the Mahshar, the resurrection. Every person will be engrossed and worried of one's own self only. It is possible that in this ayah, Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is being commanded to appear as a witness, and he fears the intense burden of being called up as a witness. It is stated in hadith that at time when this ayah was revealed, Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, O Allah, how can I be a witness of those who were not in my presence? Some of the ulama have written that at the mentioning of this ayah, the scene of Qiyamah came before him,
And the fikr, the worry of the ummah was always with Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He may have cried because of the sins of the ummah. For this, every event is such that it can be the cause of crying. All this, and besides this, there could be other reasons too for his crying. Amazing. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was crying when this ayah was being recited.
حدثنا قتيبة حدثنا جرير عن عطاء ابن سائب عن أبيه عن عبد الله ابن عمر قال إن كسفت الشمس يوما على عهد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقام رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يصلي حتى لم يكد يركع ثم ركع فلم يكد يرفع رأسه ثم رفع رأسه فلم يكد أن يسجد ثم سجد فلم يكد أن يرفع رأسه ثم رفع رأسه فلم يكد أن يسجد ثم سجد فلم يكد أن يرفع رأسه فجعل ينفخ ويبكي
سبحان الله
دفيا ويقول and he was saying ربي ألم تعدني ألا تعذبني ذبهم وأنا فيهم ربي ألم تعدني ألا تعذبهم وهم يستغفرون ونحن نستغفرك فلما صلى ركعتين انجلت الشمس فقام فحمد الله وأثنى عليه ثم قال إن الشمس والقمر آيتان من آيات الله لا ينكشفان لموت أحد ولا لحياته فإذا كشفا فافزعوا إلى ذكر الله تعالى
سبحان الله. The hadith that we did in Mishkat as well.
Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu says, in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there was once occurred a solar eclipse. According to the majority of the ulama, this incident took place in the 10th year Hijri. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went into the masjid, commenced the salah and stood in qiyam, standing position for so long that it was felt that he did not intend performing ruku. In another narration, it is stated that he recited the Surah Al-Baqarah, such a long surah, one of the longest surah in the Quran. He then performed such a long ruku as if he did not want to come up from the ruku. Then, in the same manner, after standing up from the ruku, he stood up for such a long time as if he did not want to perform sajda. He then performed the sajda. Here too, he kept his blessed head on the ground for such a long time as if he was not going to lift the blessed head. In the same manner he did the same after lifting the head and sitting in the jalsa between the sajda, and after the jalsa in the second sajda, same, meaning as if he was not going to get up, as if he was not going to go down. In short, in every part, every posture of the salah, this was done, that every posture was so long as if this posture was going to be performed till the end. Such a long time he took. And then there is nothing after it. In the same manner he performed the second rakat and in the last sajda as well, same. Due to this intense fear, he began taking heavy breath, yanfukhu, heavy breath. He started taking heavy breath and crying and began pleading to the Almighty Allah, "Oh Allah, you had promised me that in my presence you will not punish the ummah. Oh Allah, it is only you that have promised that when these people make istighfar, when they seek forgiveness, there will be no punishment." This saying of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam refers to the ayah, which is at the end of the 9th juz, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَأَنْتَ فِيهِمْ وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ مُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَهُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ, that Allah will not punish them whilst the Prophet ﷺ is amongst them, and then Allah will not punish them whilst they do istighfar. When Rasulullah ﷺ completed the salah, the sun had cleared already. Rasulullah ﷺ delivered a sermon after this, after uttering the hamd, praising Almighty Allah, etc. He talked on this subject, that the sun and the moon does not eclipse because of the death or birth of anyone, but are both from amongst the signs of Almighty Allah, that gives his creation a warning so that they may fear him. When those eclipses occur, when these type of eclipses occur, then immediately turn towards Almighty Allah, begin istighfar and performing salah. Subhanallah. The reason for delivering this sermon was that in the days of Jahiliyyah, it was famous that the eclipse of the sun and the moon were due to the death or birth of a great personality. Coincidentally, if it coincided, it so happened. Coincidentally, it so happened that when Sayyidina Ibrahim, the son of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, passed away, an eclipse took place. Therefore, this nurtured the view held in the days of Jahiliyyah. People began saying that the eclipse was the result of the death of Ibrahim radiallahu anhu, the son of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The a'imma differ in that during the solar eclipse should one or more than one ruku be performed in one rak'at. The Hanafis say that only one ruku should be performed in one rak'at, just like normal salah. This hadith strengthens their view. However, scholarly differences and the proofs of the opposite schools are not relevant here, because you're only mentioning how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam cried and how much he grieved. Amazing. حدثنا محمود بن غيلان حدثنا أبو أحمد حدثنا سفيان عن عطاء عن السائب عن إكرمة عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنه قال أخذ رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ابنة له تقضي فاحتضنها فوضعها بين يدي فماتت وهي بين يدي وصاحت أم أيمن فقال يعني النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أتبكين عند رسول الله فقالت ألست أراك تبكي ألست أراك تبكي؟ قال إني لست أبكي إنما هي رحمة إن المؤمن بكل خير على كل حال إن نفسه تنزع من بين جنبيه وهو يحمد الله تعالى. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu reports that one of the daughters of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was on her deathbed. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam picked her up and put her before him. She passed away in his presence. Amazing. Can you just imagine your own child dying in front of you? Umm Ayman radiallahu anha, who was a slave girl of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, began wailing loud. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Are you crying before the Messenger of Allah?" Because tears were also flowing from the eyes of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She said, "Do I not see you crying?" Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied, "This crying is not prohibited. It is a mercy of Almighty Allah. He softens the heart of his servants and creates love and mercy in them." Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "A Muslim is at peace at all times. Even when his soul is being taken out, he is busy uttering the praise of Almighty Allah." The ulama differ in that which daughter did this incident take place with. Which daughter was it? According to the muhaddithin and historians, this did not take place with any of his daughters, but with that of a grandson or a granddaughter. It is also possible that this took place with one of the sons. Such incidents took place with his male offspring as well, with whom severe this incident may have taken place. Or the object here is to describe the soft-heartedness of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that stone-heartedness is contrary to kindness, to have no effect in your heart. To have natural love for children is not against the dignity and sanctity of prophethood. To be soft-hearted is praiseworthy. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was crying, tears were flowing, but he wasn't making noise. That is the object. حدثنا محمود بن بشار محمد بن بشار حدثنا عبد الرحمن بن مهدي حدثنا سفيان عن عاصم بن عبيد الله عن القاسم بن محمد عن عائشة رضي الله عنها أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قبل عثمان بن مزعون وهو ميت وهو يبكي أو قال عيناه تهرقان. Aisha radiallahu anha reports Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam kissed the forehead of Uthman ibn Maz'un radiallahu anhu after his death. At that time, tears were flowing from his eyes. The great Sahabi was the foster brother of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was the 13th person to accept Islam in its early stages. He first migrated to Habasha, Abyssinia, then to Medina. He was very pious and devoted. At the time when it was still lawful to drink intoxicant, he had already abstained from it. He was the first amongst the Muhajirin to pass away. He passed away in Sha'ban in the second year Hijra and was buried in Jannatul Baqi.
SubhanAllah, what a place. Allah granted the place there as well. Amazing. So the Prophet ﷺ was kissing his forehead and he was crying.
حدثنا إسحاق بن منصور أخبرنا أبو عامر حدثنا فليه وهو ابن سليمان عن هلال بن علي عن أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه قال شهدنا ابنة لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ورسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم جالس على القبر فرأيت عينيه تدمعان فقال أفيكم رجل لم يقارف الليلة قال أبو طلحة أنا قال أنزل فنزل في قبرها.
Amazing. Another.
Anas رضي الله عنه reports رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم was sitting at the grave of his daughter. Which daughter was this? سيدتنا أم كلثوم رضي الله عنها. And tears were flowing from his eyes. While they were burying her, Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that person should enter the grave who did not have any sexual relations that night, the previous night. Abu Talha radiallahu anhu replied, I did not. At the request of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he entered inside the grave. It is said that this was an obscure hint to Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu, and that is although his wife, the daughter of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, being very ill, that she had passed away the same day he was with one of his slave girls that night. Some ulama did not translate the word lam yuqarif as the one who did not commit any cohabitation relations, but as the one who did not commit a sin. Some ulama have translated it as did not speak, as Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not like to speak after Isha. The most famous explanation is the one used above, meaning who didn't cohabitate. There is no difficulty in explaining ta'reed, an obscure hint. Two, a person does hint to one with whom one has a strong relationship. If Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu did this because of a strong urge, then there is no harm. Also, who knows when one will die? It is possible that Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to mildly bring it to his notice, but not scold him. It may not be surprising that the reason of this is that the marriage of Sayyidina Umm Kulthum radiallahu anha was important, as this took place at the command of merit, commandment of Almighty Allah, when the first wife of Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu, the elder sister of Sayyidina Umm Kulthum, passed away, Sayyidina Ruqayya. Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if I had 100 daughters, and if everyone died one after another, I would have married each one of them one after the other to Uthman.
SubhanAllah.
Jibril alayhi salam says that Allah Ta'ala has commanded that I give the hand of Sayyidatina Umm Kulthum in the marriage of Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu. In this manner, it will surely warrant that at the time of the illness of such a wife like Umm Kulthum radiallahu anha, a mild and obscure hint will be given. Allah alone knows best. So, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was burying his daughter Umm Kulthum, then this is what happened. No person in the entire history of humanity, since Adam alayhi salam, no human, has ever had the honor of marrying two daughters of any prophet. Two daughters of any prophet. Uthman radiallahu anhu is the only person who not only got married to two daughters of a prophet, but the best of all prophets. SubhanAllah. Amazing person. So alhamdulillah, that was the chapter regarding the weeping of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The next chapter is also a small chapter, and inshallah we'll quickly do it. There's only one or two hadith in here. Babu ma ja'a fi firash Rasulillahi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The chapter on the bed of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It shall be known from the following narration mentioned by the author on what type of bed did Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam rest. We who are from amongst his ummah know the state of our carpets and our furnishings, our beddings, which is before our eyes. Allah, we can then compare what type of bed we are sleeping in and what type of bed our beloved sallallahu alaihi wasallam is to sleep in. حدثنا علي بن حجر حدثنا علي بن مصحر عن هشام بن عروة عن أبيه عن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت إنما كان فراش رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الَّذِي يَنَامُ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ أَدَمٍ حَشْوُهُ لِيفٌ. Aisha radiallahu anha reports that the bed of which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam slept was made of leather, in which was filled core of palm leaves. The bed of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used was at the times made of leather, as stated in this hadith, or at times was that made of canvas, as will be mentioned in the next hadith. At times it was only a mat made of palm leaves, just a straw mat. This subject was made, has been narrated in many ahadith, that when Sahaba radiallahu anhum asked the permission to make a soft bed, Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to reply, "What do I have to do in common with worldly comforts? My example is that of a traveler who after walking stops under the shade of a tree for a while and takes a rest, and after sitting for a while continues on his way." Sayyidatina Aisha radiallahu anha says, once a woman from the Ansar came and saw that an Aba cloak was spread on the bed of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She returned home and made a bed in which she filled wool and sent it to me for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam returned and he saw the bed, he inquired, "What is this?" I replied, a certain woman from the Ansar came, and after seeing the bed of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she made and sent this bed. Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Return it. It looked good to me and I did not feel like sending it back." Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam insisted that I send it back and said, "I swear an oath that if I wish, Allah Ta'ala will line up mountains of gold and silver for me." On this saying of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I returned the bed. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu says, "I once came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was resting on a mat made of palm leaves, the marks of which could be seen on the blessed body of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam." Amazing. After seeing this state, I began to cry. Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked, "What is the matter? Why are you crying?" I replied, "O Prophet of Allah, these Qaisar and Kisra, these not even Muslims, they sleep on beds of silk and velvet, and you on this palm mat." Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "It is not a thing to cry about. For them is the dunya, for them is this world, for us is the akhirah." A similar incident once took place when Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, when he came to Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this same type of question and answer took place. The detailed incident is mentioned in Sahih Bukhari. There's a long incident. حدثنا أبو الخطاب زياد بن يحيى البصري حدثنا عبد الله بن مهدي حدثنا جعفر بن محمد عن أبيه قال سئلت عائشة رضي الله عنها ما كان فراش رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في بيتك؟ قالت من أدم حشوه من ليف. وسئلت حفصة ما كان فراش رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في بيتك؟ قالت مسحا نشيه سنيتين فينام عليه. فلما كان ذات ليلة قلت لو سنيته أربع سنيات لكان أوطأ له، فسنيناه بأربع سنيات. فلما أصبح قال ما فرشتموا لي الليلة؟ قالت قلنا هو فراشك إلا إن سنيناه بأربع سنيات. قلت هو أوطأ لك؟ قال ردوه لحالته الأول فإنه منعتني وطأته صلاة الليل ليلة. Imam Muhammad al-Baqir rahmatullahi alayhi says that someone asked Aisha radiallahu anha, Umm al-Mu'mineen, "How was the bed of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in your house?" She replied, "It was made of leather in which was filled the core of date leaves, date palms." Hafsa radiallahu anha was asked, another wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ummul Mu'mineen, "How was the bed of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in your house?" She replied, "It was a canvas folded into two, which was spread for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to sleep on. On one night, I thought if I folded it in four and spread it, it would become more softer. I folded it and spread it that way. In the morning, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked, 'What did you spread for me last night?' I replied, 'It was the same bed. I only folded it into four so that it may become more softer for you. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, leave it in its original form. Its softness deprive me from tahajjud, waking up for tahajjud prayer at night. It means that he could not wake up for tahajjud, or he may have awakened later than usual. One sleeps more soundly on a soft bed and also for a longer period. If it is a rough and uneven bed, firstly, one would not sleep with ease. Secondly, one will awaken quickly. Today our beds are too soft. It is like, memory foam and all these other type of bedding that we have. You know, this was the simple bedding of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah grant all of us the understanding. May Allah give us the ability to follow the life of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Inshallah. The next chapter is a bit of a long chapter. Babu ma jaa fi tawadu'i Rasulillahi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The chapter regarding the humbleness of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Humbleness of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Inshallah, we will do that in the next lesson. May Almighty Allah grant all of us the understanding. May Allah give us true love for Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah give us the ability to follow the lifestyle of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And may Allah give us the ability to make our life, our home, our bedding, everything as much as possible according to the way of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Inshallah, just quickly before we finish, we go through the khulasa. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to the bed of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the weeping of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He would pray, and from the chest, Subhanallah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would pray, and from his chest emanated a sound like the gurgling of a pot when it boils. He wept when the following verse was recited to him. فَكَيْفَ إِذَا جِئْنَا مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ بِشَهِيدٍ. His eyes wept out of mercy when a daughter of his died. Could have been a granddaughter or son. He wept when Sayyidina Uthman ibn Maz'un radiallahu anhu died, and also when his daughter Sayyida Kulthum radiallahu anha died at her grave. Now the bed of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his bed which he slept on in the room of Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu anha, was made of tanned leather stuffed with palm fiber. His bedding in the house in the room of Sayyidina Hafsa radiallahu anha was a hair garment or a rough woolen cloth which she once folded four times. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, return it to its former state, original state. Its softness prevented me from praying at night. This was Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah give us the ability to follow his footsteps. Ameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala rasulina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.